It is January 16th, 1940, in the frozen forests of Finland. The temperature has just dropped to minus 43 degrees Celsius, minus 45 degrees Fahrenheit. This is the second coldest winter Finland has recorded since 1828. On one side of the battlefield, Soviet soldiers huddle around traditional campfires, burning through log after log, waking every 2 hours to add more wood. By morning, thousands of them will be dead, not from bullets, from the cold. On the other side, Finnish soldiers sleep soundly through the entire night. 12 hours, uninterrupted. The fire beside them burns steadily with just 2 logs, requiring zero maintenance, throwing out heat that keeps them warm in temperatures that would kill most modern campers in under 3 hours. This is not a story. This is documented history. And here is the strangest part. The fire the Finnish soldiers used defies everything we teach about fire today. It burns upward and downward simultaneously. It uses less wood but produces more heat, and with less oxygen, it somehow burns longer. Modern survival experts call it impossible. Finnish warriors called it survival. Today, I am going to show you exactly how they did it, and why 71 people still die every year in Finland. Because we forgot. The Winter War Test. To understand why this fire technique mattered, you need to understand the war that tested it. The Winter War lasted 105 days, from November 30th, 1939 to March 13th, 1940. The Soviet Union invaded Finland with over 1 million men, expecting victory in 2 weeks. They were catastrophically wrong. What made this war uniquely brutal was the cold. The winter of 1939 to 1940 was the coldest in over a century. Temperatures regularly dropped to minus 35 degrees Celsius, and on January 16th, the Karelian Isthmus recorded minus 43 degrees Celsius. The Soviet Red Army had one critical weakness. They had only trained their soldiers to operate in temperatures down to minus 15 degrees Celsius. When the Finnish winter went below minus 30, they were operating in conditions they had never prepared for. Soviet soldiers from southern regions had never seen winter like this. They did not know how to build fires that would last through the night. Their equipment, their training, their entire survival doctrine was inadequate. The result was horrific. Of the approximately 126,000 Soviet soldiers who died in the Winter War, historians estimate that tens of thousands froze to death. Photographs from the war show frozen corpses in foxholes and trenches where their fires had gone out during the night. Finnish soldiers lost 25,000 men. 5 times fewer deaths despite being outnumbered 40 to 1. Finnish soldiers survived because they knew their own climate. They had techniques passed down through generations, methods of creating fire that worked when nothing else did. And at the center of those techniques was a fire design so simple that when you see it, you will wonder why nobody taught it to you. The problem with modern fires. Let me explain why the campfire you learned to build is terrible for survival in extreme cold. Traditional campfires in extreme cold have 3 deadly weaknesses. First, they devour wood. At minus 40 degrees, a standard campfire consumes approximately 1 log every 30 to 45 minutes. To stay warm through a 12-hour night, you need 15 to 20 logs. Imagine you are exhausted from combat and you need to gather, process and stack 15 to 20 logs before you can sleep. It is not sustainable. Second, they demand constant maintenance. A fire that keeps you warm at minus 40 cannot die down. Someone needs to wake up every 1 to 2 hours, leave the warmth and add more wood. You lose heat every time you wake. Your sleep fragments and cumulative sleep deprivation in combat can be as deadly as the cold itself. Third, heat distribution is terrible. A traditional campfire radiates heat in all directions, but at minus 40, you need concentrated directional heat. Sitting next to an open fire means one side of your body roasts while the other side freezes. Finnish soldiers called this the campfire curse. You are simultaneously too hot and too cold. So Finnish soldiers asked themselves, what if we could build a fire that burned all night on just 2 logs, required zero maintenance, and concentrated heat in one direction? The answer was so elegant that when Soviet soldiers captured Finnish positions and saw these fires still burning, they could not figure out how they worked. If you are learning something new today, hit that like button. The Rakovalkea revealed. The Finnish name is Rakovalkea, which translates as slit bonfire. In English, survival experts call it the Finnish Gap Fire. The concept is absurdly simple. Take two large logs, each 6 to 8 feet long and 8 to 10 inches in diameter. Lay them parallel with a gap of 6 to 8 inches between them. Carve a shallow channel lengthwise down the inner face of each log. Fill the gap with kindling, light it from the center, let physics take over. But within this simplicity is hidden sophisticated combustion engineering. Here is what happens when you light a Rakovalkea. The fire starts in the gap between the two logs. As the flames grow, something remarkable occurs. The fire begins burning both logs simultaneously, but not in the way you expect. The upper log burns downward, from its bottom surface into the interior. The lower log burns upward, from its top surface into its interior. The fire burns in two directions at once, defying the normal behavior of flames, which only rise. This makes experienced campers think it is impossible. Fire rises. That is basic physics. How can fire burn downward into a log? The answer is radiant heat reflection. The two logs face each other across the gap, and as the fire burns, intense heat radiates outward from the flames. But instead of dissipating into air, like in a traditional campfire, that radiant heat bounces back and forth between the two log faces. Each log heats the opposite log, creating a feedback loop. The temperature in the gap reaches between 800 and 1000 degrees Celsius, hot enough that both logs are being roasted from the inside out. The gap itself functions as a controlled combustion chamber. Air flows in from the sides, feeds the fire, and hot gases rise vertically. Unlike a traditional fire where you need constant airflow and the fire spreads unpredictably, the Rakovalkea self-regulates. The gap controls how much oxygen reaches the fire, preventing it from burning too fast. The result is a fire that burns steadily for 8 to 12 hours with just two logs. Why modern methods fail. Now let me show you exactly why this beats modern techniques. Consider fuel consumption. To stay warm through a 12-hour night at minus 40 degrees, a traditional campfire requires 15 to 20 logs. A Rakovalkea uses two logs. That is 85 to 90% less fuel. Think about what that meant in the Winter War. Every log you need to cut and haul to your position is time and energy not spent on combat operations. The Rakovalkea meant Finnish soldiers could prepare overnight heating with a fraction of the effort. Then there is maintenance. A traditional campfire must be tended every 1 to 2 hours. Over a 12-hour night, that is 6 to 12 interruptions to your sleep. Soldiers who cannot sleep make poor decisions, have slower reaction times, and are more vulnerable to hypothermia. The Rakovalkea requires zero maintenance. You light it once, and it burns unattended all night. Heat output matters enormously. A traditional campfire radiates heat 360 degrees, meaning most heat warms empty air. A Rakovalkea radiates heat primarily in two directions, outward from each side of the gap. Finnish soldiers would build a simple shelter on one side, positioning themselves so concentrated radiant heat was directed exactly where they needed it. Weather resistance is another massive advantage. At minus 40 with wind and snow, a traditional campfire is vulnerable. A Rakovalkea, burning in the protected gap between two logs, is remarkably wind resistant. The fire is sheltered, the logs block wind, and once established, it burns through almost any weather. Modern survival experts have tested the Rakovalkea extensively. In controlled experiments below minus 30 degrees, a properly built Rakovalkea maintains temperatures warm enough for human survival for 10 to 12 hours on two logs, while a traditional campfire at the same temperature requires continuous feeding of wood. We did not progress past this, we forgot it. And the cost of forgetting is measured in lives. 71 people die every year in Finland from hypothermia. Not in the 1940s, right now, in modern Finland, with GPS, cell phones, and synthetic sleeping bags, the answer is that we traded knowledge for convenience. When you can buy a portable gas stove, why learn efficient fires? When sleeping bags are rated to minus 40 degrees, why understand heat management? When cell phones can summon rescue, why master survival skills? This works perfectly until it does not. Your gas runs out. Your sleeping bag gets wet and loses insulation. Your battery dies, and there is no rescue coming. The Rakovalkea solves problems that modern campers do not even know they have, because they have never been in a situation where those problems would kill them. According to Finnish government data, of the 71 hypothermia deaths per year between 2008 and 2019, 49% involved alcohol, but the remaining 51% were sober individuals who simply did not know how to stay warm. Experienced hikers and hunters who made a mistake, got caught in bad weather, and did not have the survival knowledge to save themselves. Compare that to the Winter War, where Finnish soldiers, many of them teenagers with minimal training, survived conditions that would kill modern campers in hours. The difference was not physical toughness, it was knowledge. If this is blowing your mind, drop a like so more people learn this, how it works. For those who want to understand the engineering, let me explain why this design is so efficient. The core principle is thermal mass combined with controlled combustion. The two large logs represent enormous stored chemical energy. But instead of burning that energy quickly in a flash of flames like kindling, the design forces a slow, controlled release. Wood burns through a process called pyrolysis, where heat breaks down complex organic molecules into simpler compounds that react with oxygen. In a traditional fire, pyrolysis happens on the surface, and volatile gases burn immediately. This is fast but inefficient because much heat escapes into the atmosphere. In a Rakovalkea, pyrolysis happens deep inside the gap between the logs. The facing surfaces are being heated to extreme temperatures by radiant heat from the opposite log. This causes pyrolysis beneath the surface in the interior wood fibers. The volatile gases produced have to travel through channels carved in the logs to reach oxygen, and when they do, they burn in the controlled environment of the gap. The gap width is critical. Too narrow, and you restrict airflow to the point where combustion becomes incomplete, producing smoke. Too wide, and you lose the radiant heat reflection that makes the system work. The optimal gap is 6 to 8 inches, which Finnish soldiers determined through trial and error long before anyone understood the physics. Compare this to a traditional campfire, where combustion is chaotic and uncontrolled. Flames leap in every direction, heat radiates wastefully, and much energy in the wood is lost to the atmosphere. The Rakovalkea is a controlled draft combustion chamber, using the logs themselves as both fuel and structure. This is the same principle used in modern wood gasification stoves, in industrial boilers, and in any system where you want maximum heat from minimum fuel. Finnish loggers and hunters had perfected this technique over centuries of Arctic survival, long before modern engineers formalized the physics. How to build a Rakovalkea? Let me walk you through the construction process. Select two logs of roughly equal size, ideally 6 to 8 feet long and 8 to 10 inches in diameter. The log should be as straight as possible. Using your saw or axe, cut a flat surface on what will be the ground-facing side of each log so they sit stable and do not roll. Next, carve a shallow channel down the length of each log on the facing side. This channel should be about 2 to 3 inches deep and run almost the entire length, stopping a few inches from each end. This creates a groove for kindling and increases surface area exposed to radiant heat from the opposite log. Now position your logs. Place them parallel with the carved channels facing inward. The gap between them should be 6 to 8 inches. To keep them in position, use 4 stakes driven into the ground, 2 at each end, flanking the logs. If the ground is frozen or rocky, use logs placed perpendicular underneath as supports. Place your kindling in the gap. Start with very fine material in the center, dry bark, wood shavings or birch bark if available. Build up to small twigs, then larger sticks. Pack it loosely because you need airflow. Light your kindling in the center, not at one end. As the kindling burns, it will ignite the facing surfaces of both logs and the fire will gradually spread along the length. Here is a critical tip. The first 10 minutes are everything. Your goal is to establish a strong fire in the center that generates enough heat to begin pyrolysis of the log surfaces. If your initial kindling burns out before the logs catch, you start over. Use plenty of fine material, protect the initial flame from wind, and be patient. Once the logs begin to burn, the fire becomes self-sustaining. One finish trick. If you have birch bark, wrap it around each log at the center point where you are lighting the fire. Birch bark is waterproof and incredibly flammable, due to its oil content. It acts as a natural fire starter and ensures that even damp logs will eventually catch. Choosing the right wood. Wood selection for a Rakovalkea follows different rules than for a traditional campfire. For extreme cold survival, you want dense hardwoods, oak, beech, maple, ash, or birch. these woods have high energy density. They burn slower and produce more sustained heat. In the Winter War, Finnish soldiers preferred birch both for its density and because birch bark made excellent fire starters. Softwoods like pine, spruce and fir burn faster, but are easier to cut and more abundant. For a military force that needs to set up camp quickly, softwoods might be practical even if they burn for 8 hours instead of 12. Here is something that surprises modern campers. The Rakovalkea works with green wood. Freshly cut, unseasoned wood that would smoke terribly in a traditional campfire can work in a Rakovalkea. The extreme temperatures in the gap, 800 to 1000 degrees Celsius, are hot enough to drive moisture out of green wood before combustion. This was critical for Finnish soldiers who could not wait months for wood to season. That said, drier wood is always better. But if you are in a survival situation with only green wood, a Rakovalkea gives you options that a traditional fire does not. The Rakovalkea burns for 8 to 12 hours on two logs. It generates temperatures of 800 to 1000 degrees Celsius in the centre. It works in minus 40 degree weather. It works in wind. It works in snow. It works when everything else fails. And yet if I walked into a camping goods store today and asked for equipment to build a Rakovalkea, they would have no idea what I was talking about. They would try to sell me a portable stove, a chemical fire starter, a fancy lighter. None of which would save me if I was genuinely lost in winter and genuinely fighting for survival. 126,000 Soviet casualties versus 25,000 Finnish casualties. And while combat effectiveness and tactics played roles, historians increasingly recognized that basic survival knowledge, the ability to keep soldiers alive and functional in extreme cold, was a decisive factor. The Rakovalkea is not romantic traditionalism. It is a solution to a physics problem we still face today. How do you generate maximum heat from minimum fuel in extreme conditions? Finnish soldiers in 1940 did not have waterproof matches or magnesium fire starters or YouTube tutorials. They had axes, they had trees, and they had knowledge passed down through generations. Maybe that is all any of us really need. If you learned something from this video, consider subscribing. I explore forgotten survival techniques like this every week, showing how people in the past solved problems we still face today. And if there is another historical fire technique you want me to cover, let me know in the comments. Until next time, stay warm.